Hey, we are back. Okay. And we are ready with our first game, or at least with the first draft, so we're going to head into this in just a second. Right now, the important thing to note is that we have the game between 2 out of 10 going up against Virtus.Pro, which is actually going to be a pretty interesting match here. And Virtus.Pro, of course, also changing the lineup a bit. And these games are not kidding, these teams are not kidding around, because they already started the draft, and therefore we're going to jump right in, where we, at this point, have the bans again. Sonya banned out and an Abathur ban, which means that not only are we going to see an Uther, it's also probably going to be an Uther Kel'Thas pick now by 2 out of 10. At least that would be, in my opinion, what we would have seen by most teams so far today.
I'd agree, but 2 out of 10, I know both me and you were looking at it just for this game. We're not too familiar with any of these players, so anything could happen in this. Virtus.Pro, though, they do prioritize that Jaina over the Uther here, which is very interesting. That's a Tassadar.
And that means that it's either not going to be Uther or a Kel'Thas, or they're just completely going to go for something completely different, and Virtus.Pro gets all of that.
Let's find out. Uther, Kel'Thas, where are you going with this? Sonya's banned. Can't go with that. For those who, because obviously you guys can't see the video, Kaldor was doing football-style finger waggles.
Totally no true. There's the Kel'Thas, but okay. Let's say what we expect here. We expect an Uther for Virtus.Pro now that they have the opportunity to grab him up. Kel'Thas is still a very solid pick. Tassadar apparently is something that 2 out of 10 prioritizes even higher than Uther, which is a bit surprising considering that Uther is one of the heroes that has been banned out the most today, and also one of the heroes that allows you to... It really opens up a lot of additional possibilities if you have that Divine Shield. Let's just put it like that.
It does. It's very interesting. So Virtus.Pro, like you said, definitely going to pick that up. They'll probably pick that up as the second pick, though. Right now, they're probably thinking about what they want with it. So just making their decisions right now. They could, in theory, leave it and pick 2 more other heroes and then leave it to 2 out of 10 to ban it if they
Tyrande.
Really want to.
No? Tyrande or there is Muradin.
There is Uther. And I agree, both of those. Almost definitely what we're going with.
Yeah, I mean, you can always argue that it's Infernal Shrines and you would rather like to go down into a road where you have like additional AoE, and that's
like
what
that.
They actually do. Like that, exactly. It's the Leoric instead, but I feel like both of the heroes that we mentioned besides that going into a Muradin or Tyrande would have helped as well.
I think we'll see some bans on at least 1 or 2 of them.
Yeah, having that snipe potential is just pretty nice. So we're going to go into the bans and... Well, that's the moment where we're going to see a bit more how exactly 2 out of 10 is going to shape this up. They have the next 2 picks too, so it's not only about the bans here. It's actually like pretty impossible to predict what they're going to ban out here, considering that this lineup or the setup that they started with a Tassadar.
Yeah, second you throw in a Tassadar above Kael'Thas, like the fact that they picked Tassadar before Kael'Thas as well, even though it was in the same lineup, and no Uther, it's just thrown everything for a loop.
It's like... Did you have a plan or a stroke? Like one of the two. So right now we're going to find out what. I mean, with the Tassadar, you can always argue that you can play him with the melee assassin very well, since you have talents that you can rely upon right now, like the Leeching Plasma or level 4. You have a few options there. But they actually take their sweet time with the ban. And as we already said, banning out a Tyrande, banning out a Muradin would really slow the process on the side of Virtus.Pro. But instead of banning a Muradin, they ban Arthas, which is, of course, a very strong four-liter stand. But I guess, as you already were about to say, they probably pick Muradin themselves.
Yeah, Tyrande banned out, so they can't pick her. So, like you said, Muradin, definitely a very viable choice for 2 out of 10. And I'm more than prepared to be proved wrong.
I mean, let's just put it this way. Virtus.Pro just went for the safe play. They said, like, all right, let's ban out Tyrande. It's the safest thing that we can do right now, and see where they take it from here. Muradin is likely, since they didn't ban him out. There is Johanna. Are they going to go for Muradin as their second frontliner, which would leave them...
Nope.
It would leave them a bit weak on the damage side. They would heavily rely on... it's more likely right now that they're playing a single tank, of course. But that's an interesting setup there. I mean, what exactly do you make of this?
I make that apparently they don't put much priority on hard stun, from what I can work out here. Both Uther neglected, picking up Johanna instead of Muradin. Like, Muradin is a very safe pick. Johanna is a bit safer due to the fact that she has Iron Skin, which makes her a bit more stun immune, so she can wade in a bit harder. But it's a very interesting comp at the moment. A lot of spread damage from Kael'Thas, a lot of focus damage from Zagara. It's weird.
Not very meta.
It's not very meta in the slightest, but like all the heroes themselves are fairly meta, just not like this.
Yeah.
And especially not in this order.
It's definitely an interesting setup that they have. I mean, they're still lacking a heal where they could head into Charism, into Malfurion. Malfurion would combo well with the root after Maw. That's something that they can use. Virtus.Pro is probably also thinking about, okay, what exactly do we make of this? Do we add a Meridian to our own comp? With them, by the way, not picking Meridian, with 2 out of 10 not picking Meridian, that ban on Arthas is really interesting to me. It's not like Arthas is bad, he's really strong, but whoa, and then Vikings, we have the Vikings. Okay. Vikings on this map actually are pretty solid. Yeah. They're pretty cool because you can get far ahead in experience, especially at the first one. So I would say that this is right now probably the best Vikings map that we have in the pool.
That was one of the side effects of the change in the amount of demons need to get. Just the fact that you're there for so much longer.
Yeah.
The Vikings can, as Carlos said, get a huge amount of XP in Virtus.Pro. But their last pick, second tank, another frontliner, another extra damage. Plenty of options here.
Yeah. I mean, Leoric as a solo tank is something that we don't see all that often, but you can definitely play it. There's still the option with the Meridian, and I like that they go for it since we've been talking about like the stun combos already and the damage that Jaina can get in. So, yeah, it's a bit of an interesting setup that we have there. The Vikings catering to the map, especially the changes that Blizzard implemented. If you've not, like, I have lost against that stuff like a couple of times. I actually met the pirate, like, we queued with like a random comb and queued into the pirates at some point, and they played that style and they destroyed us so hard. I couldn't sit down for like a week. It was brutal. And there's Malfurion, as we already suspected, as the healer for 2 out of 10. And that allows them to go into a lot of routes after the setup with potential more.
Yeah, they have a lot of potential engage. And that is the key word in there, potential. In fact, they have to land it all very, very nicely. Like, more into a root, into storm, into, well, Kael'thas. It's a lot of damage if they can land it. Otherwise, they're going to die very quickly due to the fact they'll just get stunned by Meridian and then stun locked until Jaina can kill them.
I'm really interested to see how this works now. Because, first of all, when you, like, see the setup, I could have actually... Okay, let's assume for a second that the original plan going into this game for Virtus.Pro was try and secure themselves a Viking composition.
Yeah.
The whole idea between the Vikings here is that now the fights for the objectives are prolonged because Blizzard changed the map, so now you have to get 40 minions instead of 30, which actually adds a lot of time. And right now with the Vikings on all of the lanes, you can get a massive amount of experience that gives you a lead for the rest of the game. If Virtus.Pro actually decided or was trying to go into a setup like this from the beginning, I could have actually seen them changing that plan after they saw the draft of 2 out of 10 because it allowed them to get a lot of other heroes that really have a lot of synergy on the map here. They still have a very dangerous setup and they can make a lot of this happen. They have AoE thanks to Jaina. They have the Skeleton Swing on Leoric, which also helps. Later on, it's going to be the Longboat, even though at the beginning we're going to have, of course, first of all, a lot of experience soaked through the Vikings. And they have the Meridian plus the Taranda for the additional lockdown. So that is... No, they don't have Taranda.
No, they have Uther.
Uther, exactly. So they have a bit of a stun combo there as well if they get a Jaina close. Stun with Meridian, go in with Uther, stun again, drop the Blizzard. Whereas we don't have too much synergy on the side of their opponents, but they still can combo that root with a Maw, drop the bombs, Flame Strike, maybe
Sidestorm,
even...
Storm, even Archon maybe splash damage from that?
Yeah, could be. I mean, Archon is not that popular anymore since it lost like roughly 20% of the damage compared to pre-patch. But it's still there, and if you need that damage and you don't really find a reason to use the Force Wall, why not add it? I mean, like, it's horrible.
It is the Heroes of the Storm equivalent of the StarCraft Archon toilet, where instead of putting the Archon in the toilet, it just sits on the outside and then autos when people come out the more.
Not quite. Don't get me started with that. I had enough nightmares with that crap. 200 supply, Archon toilet, boom, it's gone.
2v2 was the worst of it. Just the Archon, the nuke toilet, and obviously the best of all, the Baneling toilet.
There might be some old school viewers out there that still and there's one match that we'll never forget that was actually on Daybreak back then when we had, I don't know who the Protoss was. I was trying to like put that away. I'm trying to just like forget about that. Lucera was playing and dominated that game. It was brutal. It was a slaughter. Yeah. And he had like a gazillion Broodlords. He had like everything. And at the end of the game, a 40 or 50 minute game, he moves to the bottom left of the map. He gets Archon Toilet, and within a second, he loses 130 supply.
Oh my god.
Well, my Zerg heart was crying. It was crying. It was.
Well, there is the other one, which was the GSL finals between Squirtle and I don't know who it was against.
Squirtle versus MVP.
I think so. And it was like 200 supply of Ghost Battle Cruiser, one void, not void prison. What is it called?
Protoss Imba.
But it was like one toilet, couple like three archons, a load of High Templar, and then about 20 void rays that just came from the side, and they just destroyed everything.
Like the Koreans would say, like Protoss Kesagi. That I have nothing more to add than that. But yeah, we have of course a little focus here on Heroes of the Storm, where we have also a bit of process. Thank God force fields are not as imba here as they are in StarCraft.
It's pretty good. It's got a pretty short cooldown.
Yeah,
now.
It is a pretty short cooldown. That's right. So it's still pretty good. But yeah, so before we like talk any more about that, let's jump into the game. We have Infernal Shrines already loading up. Actually, I think we're done. Yep. And of course, let's jump straight into the game, ladies and gentlemen. With a bit more action here. And yeah, this is going to be a good one. I'm actually liking the setup that we're having. So yeah, so with this, we have to the left side of the map currently 2 out of 10. Personally, I would have preferred 6.5 out of 10 for, like, yeah, well, historical good reasons. In this case, though, these boys are playing it with Quillarion on Zagara. We have Wolfts on Johanna, Gromt on Malfurion, Surgeon on Kel'Thas, and the Endo Rocket on Tassadar. The right side on the map, on the other hand, it is Virtus.Pro with BKB playing Leoric. We have Sefkaja on Jaina, Gela on Mirrodin, Andilendi on the Lost Vikings, and Unstable is playing Wither.
So, right now, very interesting lineups, and the Vikings going for a full free lane split, and Andy even trying to use just Balog in the middle lane to body block the minions a bit. He's like the one Viking body block on the minions. Didn't do a too good a job. He slowed it down like a tiny bit, like you'll see the result. He did it.
Eric goes, I got this. But yeah, so we have the Vikings with the Viking bribery on level 1. No real big surprises with the level 1 talents, I want to say. I mean, there's nothing that where you really look at the board and you're saying like, oh my god, why did he do that? Pretty standard. Khajuran's Pursuit not taken. Instead, it's the Deep Chill. There's a lot of stuff that he can do with that. Zagara actually at the top lane already destroyed, and Virtus.Pro is basically their way of saying hello.
Yeah, and Andilendi actually using Olaf there to tank the tower so his team could dive, because, well, it's Olaf. He can just heal it all back up with his trait.
Yeah, and at this point, we have the rotation still happening. And this is like this boys is the power of Vikings already. You soak two of the lanes with just a Viking on each, and then you just roam with four heroes. The main reason for this is, of course, that once the objective is really spawning on the map, with the changes that we've seen Blizzard implement, the fights take a lot longer, and that's time that the Vikings can use to split soak experience. And we will see that in just a bit when that temple is announced.
Yeah, it is very interesting. As long as you don't die on the Vikings, it doesn't matter if you lose the lanes a little. Because, well, your team can roam down and try and gank people if you start to lose the lane a lot.
Yeah, we have in the middle, again, a big fight here. Surgeon in a bit of trouble. BKB with the Wraithwalk moving back for now. Top lane, that's where we have the Shrine activated.
Yeah, they're beginning to work their way up, just grabbing a minion or two on the way. There's no way Zagara will start this on her own. Just popping in and out, though. Just getting ready to put some creep down, just seeing if anyone snuck in there. Baylog does go down in the mid lane, so that will be a lane without soak. And as such, Olaf heading down to the mid lane to soak there instead. And he'll just rely on his team, who are grabbing the demons, to soak the top lane.
And they already grab a fair amount of those, even before anything else starts. The rotation of 2 out of 10 is starting now. They are the first ones to hit level 4, but it doesn't really give them a huge window, since we have the same talent now also for their opponents. Lockdown and the kill against Jaina. And a lot of damage against the remaining three heroes.
Yeah, they're right now, Virtus.Pro not actually able to get back into the shrine location. They're down a hero. They're down two heroes, technically, due to the fact that the Vikings are completely spread out. So they're currently fighting 3 versus 5. However, look at that XP bar trickle up for Virtus.Pro.
Yeah, they just have to prolong this for as long as they can. We also have Leeching Plasma taken for Tassadar. God knows why, to be honest.
Zagara?
Well, maybe, but like, there's no melee assassin that can really completely capitalize on it, which is usually what you see. So I'm not quite sure what exactly they want to achieve with the talent. They lose Kel'Thas first. That's actually, considering that it's a 4 versus 5, essentially, pretty bad. But there's the kill against Jaina to even things out, with BKB now moving away too. He should be able to survive here. Oh, and he does, maybe. Oh, unstable
it's
with the attempted heal.
It's still
run,
going.
Run, buddy, run. That Hydra is not joking, but yeah. And you look at the XP bar. They have level 6 already. They have at the bot lane Undylandy, who, by the way, took the Mercenary Lord as the talent for himself. Wow. So that can help him. Like, imagine later on when they have the same scenario and they can just get a camp before that happens. There's now the Punisher. But they are having experience, Virtus.Pro, that is. So far, their plan has been working.
Yeah, almost a full level ahead in experience. So they're just going to defend this top lane for the moment while the Vikings continue to soak. Eric was able to dodge out of Kael Fast, so didn't get taken down. Two Vikings in the mid lane are actually dueling with Tassadar a little here, but with Kael Fast coming in, they'll be forced back up and we will lose Baylog. Olaf will be able to get out.
Yeah, but the Punisher is now down, and look at that experience bar again. Level 7 is ready. We have Ghastly Reach taken. Already the chase at the top. Muradin, the stun hits Malfurion, and here comes that storm. Bam! And Malf is down. That old geezer biting the dust here. But the rest of Team 2 out of 10 is already rotating to the top, trying to get revenge for him. But it looks like they are going to lose Surgeon instead.
Yeah, Surgeon does go down. BKB going very far forward. Not going to go any more greedy than he already has, though. And Sevka, not in any danger here. Unstable, as his level 7 talent did take Wave of Light. So a bit of mana regen for him there. And it hasn't helped because he's currently Oom.
Yeah. Cooldown reduction is even more important there, so you get like a lot of spam. If you get like all of the, like if you hit properly with it.
It helps with the Vikings, just because you get the extra targets with it.
Exactly, with the Vikings is actually pretty sweet. We have now also on level 7, Kala's Embrace again for the extra shields that still last if it expires. That can be pretty powerful. I'm still not 100% certain what exactly you're going to get out of that Leeching Plasma.
Well, it's not just for heroes. I guess you could throw it on mercenaries and get the heal out of it, because it's not limited to heroes. It's just targets attack damage.
Yeah, but
his return, like throw it on an impaler, maybe. It's weird, but I don't know. You can use it right now. Kael Fast getting focused down in the bot lane. He's done a very good living bomb, but doesn't help him. BKB with the Wraith Walk picks him off.
I don't really dislike the talent itself. I think it's a great talent, but I feel for it to really have a huge effect, you need like a Sonya, an Illidan maybe, like some kind of melee assassin or at least a heavy hitting warrior. I could even see it on a Tyrael, for example. So in that case, that would be something that would work out. But right now, they are starting to fall behind, and they are falling behind quite a bit. So the Shrine is activated again. Sefka and his boys are already waiting there. Guess who's hitting level 10 first? Sagara is even at the top lane, not even bothering about this, because they realize they won't be able to get anything done before level 10 hits, and there it is.
Maybe the Leeching Plasma's for him. Maybe he is just going Archon and just doesn't want to die. But then again, like that's 1 out of 5 for that Leeching Plasma. But now though, Gila clearing mid lane, they know they have that Shrine under control. BKB's got that.
Kulerion, by the way, went for the rapid incubation on level 7. A great talent for lane sustain. It's amazing how long you can stay on lane with it. But the kill against Kel'Thas at the top. Wolves is also down. It's a double kill again. They still have Leoric at the Shrine, gathering even more minions, and they will get that Punisher. But just look at the aggression that we're seeing from the Russian team. Moving just from lane to lane, getting their kills, and 7 kills against 2.5 now. And then not stopping there. They're taking down Zagara as well. Kulerion, all that lane sustain doesn't help you if you are alone and outmatched against these two.
Yeah, right now we are seeing Virtus.Pro even just taking every mercenary camp on the map. They're going to be able to get this bruiser camp up in the top lane, and then they just have to send a single Viking up there, which they're not doing, to buff them with that mercenary lord. Instead, the entire team's up there, so that will be 2 shamans there.
Yeah, 2 out of 10 is trying to defend here down to the bot lane. They have level 10 off finally. That gives them opportunity. They go indeed into Archon. So we see Archon taken now. And at this point, I guess Tassadar is just going to hit that shield on himself.
Yeah,
he's probably the
greedy.
Best. He's the hero that benefits the most from the talent at this point.
Yeah, like Zagara gets a little bit of damage from her Envenom Spines, but it's damage over time. But you get 20% extra range, so you can harass from further away. It's a very weird talent. Like you said, it's just for him.
Yeah. Well, for now, we have one down into the bot lane. BKB again moving in here, pushing Surgeon away. It's still a 2-level lead, 1.5-level lead, I want to say, that we are seeing for Virtus.Pro. So far, things are actually working out quite well for them. I mean, they have 8 kills against 2.5. They're doing well. They are ahead. They will have hit level 13. They haven't won this game yet, though, and there is still a chance for 2 out of 10 winning one of these team fights. I mean, at this point, they finally can fight back, but they will fall behind again once that Virtus.Pro hits 13.
Yeah, and Virtus.Pro literally just hit it, so they are behind. There is the jump on the Vikings. Burning Rage on Muradin. Shrink Ray on the Uther, Jaina and Leoric. There we go, improved Ice Block and the Crushing Hope.
And again, the split on Andy Lendi, soaking the experience here for his team, like the entire time, is up at the top right now, soaking that. And yeah, putting the spin in, we're having another fight down here at the bot lane. On the other hand, the extra talent doing work for Virtus.Pro, but it looks, oh, there's nice the maw already used. We have a nice blizzard there for the zone for a second. Gela already an avatar, they're moving in. Condemn has been used. And BKB blocking them beautifully, walking in with Wraithwalk, blocking the path of escape. They go for Ender Rocket after they just took down Johanna. Very well played here by the Russian team. And they also secured now that Bruiser camp, which is of course getting even, or got at least for a short amount of time, buffed by that Viking staying close.
Yeah, they're really not using this Mercenary Lord much for anything other than tanking the Mercenary camps at the beginning. Like, we're really not seeing the efficiency out of it.
I really think that tanking is one of the main things that they really want to do here, and they're doing it quite well.
Why would you not take extra damage if it was offered to you?
Yeah, you can keep a Viking on these lanes. The thing is, though, that every single time they have like a Mercenary camp there, it's usually an immediate rotation that follows from the opponent's team, so that also exposes the Viking to a bit more danger. I feel it would be perfect if they could time it well with a shrine activating on the map. That would probably be the best.
They're actually getting some of it out from this bottom impaler camp at the moment, just getting a bit of a push. But Chaos Blast, like I said, rotated down, clearing that up.
Yeah, and well, he doesn't have Chain Bomb yet, but he will hit that talent soon, and that helps them. There's, by the way, that additional temple. We already have 33 taken out of 40, and BKB is just taking them slowly and steadily. There's no chance for the opponent's team to get anything done about
Where
this.
Where is Gela going? Where are you going, Gela?
Well, they are waiting for someone to sneak in. It's a pretty decent trap.
Oh, they're just going in. We're bored. Going in. Going to try and kill him off. Nice! Gravity lapse. But he's already been shrink rayed, so he is slowed. There is the blitz to slow him even more. Water elemental. And come on, the heal, the shield! Gale, that's still alive, and now they're turning around to try and get people here. The more only hitting Muradin, though.
Yeah, and the Punisher is still active in the middle. Let's not forget about him. We have also now the chain bombs, of course. Punisher is doing some work here at the top lane. Experience soaked by Andy Lendi, who so far has not had those Vikings together once, even. He didn't have to.
He did once over the top bruiser fight when he actually went into the boat form to kill everyone.
Ah, yeah, you're right, you're right. I completely forgot about that. Yeah, totally right. So once he had his ult ready and he went for it. Now level 16 talents here. We have now the renewed swing. We are even seeing the executioner taking on the Vikings.
Oh, I like it. Especially, well, you have Jaina and Leoric.
And you have Give Him the Axe also using that here.
It's going to be fun.
Yeah, that's really going to be fun for them. That's going to be a pretty tough battle for the blue team here. 2 out of 10 is not going to have an easy time with this.
Yeah, and to point this out, the Executioner is 40% extra damage. Give Him the Axe 75% extra damage against CC targets.
Yeah, and that CC comes especially from BKB with that renewed swing that he has. That skeleton swing in itself is already great. And then you have the Ghastly Reach for it too. So pretty nice synergy between the heroes. Look up to the top once again. Andy Lendi just like soaking camps there.
Just Baylog, he got this just on his own. That is a good use of Murklord.
They are actually doing this really well. That Murklord talent is allowing him to send a Viking to any camp and always take those quite easily. And he's taking another one already as we speak in mid lane now. Whereas everybody else is just like rotating up to the top lane to deal with the Bruiser camp that was taken a bit earlier.
Yeah, and they're just getting these. Like, how many bribe stacks they have? They have a bribe stack, just not using it. Just like Olaf's just been left here in the top one. Eric down in the bot camp waiting for that. That's got 13 seconds left. And Baylog soaking mid lane.
Yeah, and the rest of the team is up at the top creating space for the Vikings. It looks like the blue team is just basically saying, okay, screw this. We can't chase them the entire game. Let's just like push in and try to go through the middle. But they will lose a lot more than they're going to gain here. And the temple is going to be up in another 20 seconds again. And this is not enough time for them to hit level 16.
Yeah, they're trying to basically get a fort here. And they get the fort. But in the meantime, well, Virtus.Pro are knocking on their front door in the top lane, attempting to at least take down the wall so they have an easier time going for that keep. They're not going to go all the way, though. Instead, just going to back up. He could be just grabbing the globe because he wants it for his reanimation. He's going to rejoin his team, and they'll head down to the bot lane to get that shrine.
Yeah, in the bot lane, we could even see Andy Lendi try to get one of these camps right now to use it with the Mercenary Lord while the shrine fight is happening. But they are going just simply for that fight here. 16 isn't ready yet for 2 out of 10. Can they get that talent and maybe contest? I don't really feel they can. I mean, they have 60 now, but nearly 20 of these minions have already been accumulated by Virtus.Pro.
Yeah, we will see. An Arcane Punisher will be what comes out of this. And we do see A bit of a move in here from 2 out of 10. Andy Lendy with the flank, scaring away Tassadar here. Has to jump because he was rooted, and there we go, separating off Olaf because of that Chamber Wolf's trying to group people together so they can get that Chamber Wolf, and there is the boat.
Yeah, boat is already in. We have, by the way, also the Resonation taken here. So we have that slow on the Psionic Storm, which is very interesting. A talent that I have so far not seen in competitive play, I have to admit. Again, they're moving. Great wow. Blizzard taking down Kel'Thas. They go for Wolves, and down goes Johanna. Great play and a very solid position right now for Virtus.pro, and they are going to try and exploit that. They go straight for Malfurion.
Yeah, the Arcane Punisher just rushing through here as well. Could jump onto Malfurion here as he's the furthest person forward. He's trying to run away to like bait the Punisher. Instead, he just dies and the Punisher all ends the building. Qularian trying to get away here. Unstable does not have his stun up. BKB gets him with the swing.
Yeah, Tassadar is actually surviving for now, but well, not any longer. Is he? No. Oh, the swing takes him on. Tassadar with a very creative build, I have to admit. I mean, yeah. In this case now, having that slow on the Storm. When I saw the icon, I was actually thinking, why would you go for the second strike if you don't go for Static Charge on level 7? It doesn't really make too much sense there. And then I checked it, and it was the slow instead. Not really too much synergy with the rest of the team in this case. Now, I feel like he felt pressured into some kind of control attempt during the fights.
Well, doesn't matter in this case, because Virtus.pro are able to take the game. They hit the level 20. And are just able to wipe the core there with the help of that Punisher. And that takes them 1-0 in this series.
Yeah, really, really well played here. So it's Virtus.pro, which they just like take the game. I mean, like 14 kills against 3.5, great rotations on the map. The Vikings also very, I mean, they really added a lot to
them. Yeah, I am just about to look at stats here. So we get XP, 24,000 XP on the Vikings compared to the next highest, which is 8,000 via Jada and Johanna.
I mean, to be fair, we basically had throughout the entire game, except for like two occasions, a Viking on every lane.
Yeah.
They got camps as well, but besides that, when they were not taking camps, there was a Viking on every lane. He is of course being replaced by Gela just recently. Andy Lendy, in this case, really keeping the lane experience, and the only time when he really got the Vikings together was for those two fights that we had.
He also only, if I remember correctly, he lost one Viking. That was Baylog at the start. Like, it doesn't show up at the end unless you get full kit, like enough to get a full kill on it. But I can only remember one going down. So Andy Lendy rocking the Vikings this game.
Yeah, playing this really well. And I mean, of course, Virtus.pro now with the lead, which could also mean that the next map might be the last of the day. Guys, before we jump into game number 2, we're going to have a short break. And once we're back, we will have the next map between Virtus.pro and 2 out of 10 here at the WCA Europe Qualifier. Might be the last map of the day. Keep in mind that we're going to be back tomorrow at 4 p.m. CEST. There's, of course, also going to be a time change, if I'm correct, tonight.
Yep, the clocks go back on the 25th by 1 hour because RIP summer.
Exactly. And tomorrow, then, we're going to have the semifinals, the bronze match, and the final. But now we're going to jump into a short break, and then we're back with the next map between 2 out of 10 and Virtus.pro. All right, everybody, we are back with our next game, and actually we're going to jump into the map in just a second. We have our draft started up already. It is Tomb of the Spider Queen, and well, without further ado, let's just start that immediately. And yep, look good. So we have right now a ban on Kel'Thas, which yeah means that we could see that Uther ban now for Virtus.Pro. I feel like this is one of, I don't know, what about you? In this situation, when I play against a team that has already shown me in the last game that they don't really respect Uther as a first pick and they prioritize other heroes, do you still ban him?
Nope. I take the risk. I know I would. Virtus.Pro, I don't think they care that much. I think they will ban out something else. But the question is, what do you ban? Because there was nothing that ban-worthy on the side of 2 out of 10 last
game. I mean,
game.
You can ban out the Jaina now that you already have the ban on Kel'Thas, but no, they decide to go into the ban on Uther. They go standard here. Better safe than sorry, I suppose. The Jaina is therefore being picked up by 2 out of 10, and Virtus.Pro... Oh, I know what's coming here. I like that. Virtus.Pro is going to go to Randa, Tassadar, and I suppose that's the only supports that we're going to see.
I think that would be quite fun. I think that will be very fun. I will love it if they just throw Morales in there as well. Just like, yep, supports. We need them.
Actually, like, that's the question right now. Do they play the style where they really head into the damage Tyrande? Or do they just simply say, hey... Like, for me, it's like this thought process. If you play damage Tyrande, do you still... I mean, you can still go for the heal with the Shadowstalk. But if you go damage Tyrande, you might miss out. If you play the old school Virtus.Pro style, you miss out on the level 13 talent because they really like to go into the Huntress Fury. You could swap that out against Overflowing Light anyways and say, like, okay, we're playing a bit of a mix, which is still fair enough. Or you can just still say, hey, we have Tyrande and we have Tassadar. We can why play a healer with this? After we've seen Tyrande solo or Tyrande already solo today, and you already have a Tassadar in here, I don't really think they need one. And they are actually the team that even before we had the changes, tried to play her solo.
Yeah, they did try it. And 2 out of 10, they're going a bit more standard. They're bringing out the Muradin here. And they do have their second pick as well. There's the Zagara, so they have their damage.
Zagara, yeah. So Zagara. We have the pushing power for them. Question, of course, is also, what do you ban out now if you're Virtus.Pro? What is the one thing? I would probably, just to be on the safe side, ban out a Sylvanas here. Looking at this...
Well, you get first pick after bans. Do you want it?
No, I don't want it. But I just want to make sure that they don't get Zagara, Sylvanas. I mean, right now, it's just personal preference. I don't really think that's what they're going to do. They limit the heal options instead. And that already indicates even more that we might see them with just this setup for the heals. Yeah. But yeah, the one thing... I've seen like a couple of teams fall into the trap where they underestimate Zagara, Sylvanas. And yeah, run into... a strong push lineup that just like overwhelms them, but still like Virtus.Pro, I feel like they are on a skill level probably a bit ahead of their opponents here. So right now the picks for them. Do we see Sonya?
I don't know. I kind of want, if they're going for another support, I want them to pick it now due to the fact that it would mean that every pick and ban they will have made so far will be from the support roster. Just because that will be amusing, but it's almost definitely not. I would say their damage dealer, whoever that is going to be. Maybe worry, but I think damage is more likely what they're going to pick.
I would like to see a Sonya, to be honest with you, for them.
I'd say so.
If you think about what exactly Tassadar brings to the table, on this map you can play with it for a couple of different styles. You can go either for a focus on a mental acuity so that you get vision on the turning points and what's going on there, or you're playing with a leeching plasma, and if you do that, then you need a hero that can really benefit from it, which would in this case be a potential Sonya. So I could see them do that. But yeah, I'm very curious. There's a Vala already. Don't mind Vala here. But let's see what they're doing to shape that draft up even more.
Yeah, so they have Vala. I still think Sonya could be coming in here quite nicely. There's no chance of 2 out of 10 banning it out. But there's a very small chance they could take it with Rhaegar just to make themselves more comfortable. Just to make sure it's not on the enemy side. And Rhaegar would be able to manage it barely. So I think there's a good chance if VP are picking it, they will pick it now.
And the only reason why I would see them pick another support is to really pick even more supports away from 2 out of 10.
Yeah, but they're still going to be left with Malfurion or Rhaegar, which isn't even Morales even. It's not a terrible lineup to be left with.
There's the Sonya. I like that. I really like the Sonya. That was something that works just so well if you go for Tassadar. And I think that also brings us to Leeching Plasmaster level 4 talent over the potential mental acuity.
Yeah, and this time there's someone to put it on.
Sorry?
And this time there's someone to put it on.
Exactly.
Like Tassadar himself.
Exactly. So that's what we're probably going to see there. They don't really have another front line. I mean, if we talk front line, Johanna is still available. We have Leoric that they already showed, so you can go for those. Or you could just like say screw that and take another melee assassin.
Maybe. If they're... Well, frontline at the moment, there's not a huge amount... Like, there's two stun, potentially, on the side of Virtus.Pro. We were talking about ETC earlier. This is a map he can get a lot of globes on and can go for a very tanky build if he takes his Prog Rock on level 1 and roams between lanes for globes. But I don't think it's likely. But this is one of the maps it could work on.
Well, there's the Rhaegar as the pick for 2 out of 10 over the potential Malfurion. And the last pick... I mean, they have the potential to go into that double warrior setup, or they're just going to go extra damage or push by adding another hero like Sylvanas, Falstad, Raynor. All of them good options.
Yeah.
It's actually also a hero that we could theoretically see for Virtus.Pro. I don't really think, though. I mean, we have already Vala, which is most likely going to be played by Sefkaja. Even though he could play Tauranda as well. Like, they have the option of like shifting that. There is Sylvanas! That's the push lineup that I've been talking about. That's that is actually... Up to level 10, I feel it's dangerous.
Yeah, if they get an advantage.
Yeah. If you get that advantage, you can push to keep very early. Wow. Okay, I did not see that coming.
Diablo 1, ETC, and quite a lot of other warriors, 0. So we have 10 and Diablo picked more than ETC in this game. Breath and more than Anubarak.
Breath of Fire Force Wall, calling it right now. They saw that Reddit GIF. They saw. Yeah. They know.
We can do that. Throw a strafe in there.
Yeah, they're like, okay, we're going to give that a shot. okay, this is pretty sweet. Let me think for a second. Could we see Apocalypse? What do we have as a setup for Apocalypse, theoretically?
Reign of Vengeance.
Reign of Vengeance, and I mean, theoretically, Leap, which I do not think is going to happen.
If they could get to level 20, Leap, Ariat, Crater, Apocalypse, or even just Leap, Ariat, Crater, Breath of Fire at level 20 would be
screw Ariat, Crater. I hate the talent. I really think it's bad. It's horrible.
I also agree, but it can set up the most ridiculous of wombos. Like you're missing out on you're missing out on Ignore Pain and Nexus Blaze. There's like so many things you're missing out there.
You're not gonna give up. You're not gonna give up Breath of the Berserker.
Yeah.
But I mean, like in theory, you can lead with a stun, go into Apocalypse. You can drop the Reign of Vengeance on top of it.
Rain, Leap, Fire. There's a possibility, but I don't feel that's what we'll get. And I'm sure.
Yeah, me neither. I really think they're gonna play it standard on that part. They have like the interrupts and this, but that's definitely. That's a pretty fun setup. That's really not what I expected here, not at all. And I'm liking it. I'm pretty excited for this one. This should be nice.
I'm very excited for the Diablo in general. It's going to take him like no time to fill up his souls, for starters, due to the fact that he can roam between lanes and just get all the minions.
One of the cool things about Virtus.Pro in general is it's also sometimes really their downfall is they are the team in the European scene that is probably the most willing to experiment.
Yeah.
And they do that in a lot of like weekly tournaments. We've seen them with ridiculous comps. And the cool thing about that is like when it works, you're a genius. Like you're the guy who made it happen, who like shifted the meta. I mean, think back to the days where we had quadruple blood for bloods. Guess where that came from?
Oh, yeah.
That was Virtus.Pro all the way. Back then they were still called Arthur's Stratum. Right now, if it doesn't work, of course, you look silly, and especially Twitch is going to be like, of course it didn't work. What were you thinking?
Well, VP have managed to do that in one series when we were casting them, where basically they did pick Bloodlust with Forward Momentum Rhaegar. The first game, nailed it. It was the best thing ever. Second game, rubbish. They got wrecked.
They completely lacked the auto attack heroes in the second game. But in the first game, that Bloodlust comp was brutal. Yeah, it was
like
amazing.
Kael Thas and someone else for like their autos, and it was like, where's your auto damage for this?
I mean, the most embarrassing moment for Virtus.Pro that I've probably seen was when they were trying to use a combo with Thrall, Earthquake, and Gazlo, and that backfired.
That sounds amazing.
That backfired so hard, and the problem wasn't the combo. The problem was the combo that we're trying that into, where every single hero of the opponent's team had a stun. And that didn't work out at all. And I asked them later, and they were like, yeah, we probably went a little bit overboard for this. But they had amazing combos. They reinvented the meta several times, and they are just like a team that an occasion, and this is one of them, will say, hey, we have something. It works in our scrims. We had success. We're going to try that right now. Yeah. And that's exactly one of the reasons why we're seeing this here. They had a very good game, number one. They were saying, like, hey, we are better than these boys. We had a great game here. We were using the Vikings. Everything worked out well. We are ahead in the series. We feel that we can pull this off right here. So let's try this right now. If it works, it's great. If it doesn't work, then we still have the last map where we can go.
Yeah, we have a bit of a delay before the game starting. Apparently, one of the players is AFK. Feel free to name and shame if they take a little bit longer. But, yeah, I agree. Virtus.pro definitely have been one of the most innovative teams.
One of the other things that we, of course, have in this setup now as well, which is actually also old school, we still have that setup with Tyrande and Diablo, which is... Was it the first one that was actually used? I guess
no,
we started with Muradin.
It was Stitches.
Yeah, Stitches, Muradin.
It was Stitches, Tyrande first, and then it moved to Muradin, Tyrande, and then ETC Tyrande, I would say, was the next one after that. That was a thing for quite a while.
I don't really... Yeah. Either way, that were combos that were happening with Tyrande. Diablo Tyrande was another one.
Yeah.
So that is actually a thing where you
those
can get...
came in about the same time. Like, that was when Diablo and ETC were like the two very high pick warriors, like when ETC was stage diving. Yeah. Just so, the early game.
So we could definitely see, like, again, the stun combination. And we also have then a Sonya to capitalize on that. Stun, stun into Sonya, spear, and slam damage. So... you get a lot of this, and this is something that they're probably going to try and show us right now. So that is definitely dangerous. That is a bit of old school style, and I mean, like, if you want to keep Diablo alive, who better to pull that off than a Tassadar with the new talents and also, of course, a hero like Tyrande. So guys, we're going to go into the game right away, try to check that out, and yeah, let's see if Virtus.pro is going to be successful here. To the left, we have their opponents. It is, as you can see, Kulerion playing Muradin. We're having also, oh, the overlay is unfortunately the wrong way. Apparently, like, they switched in the lobby, so we're going to change that in a second, so my apologies for that. We have Kulerion on Muradin, we have Wolves on Jaina, they're playing for 2 out of 10, Gromst on Rhaegar, Surgeon on Sylvanas, and Endo Rocket with that push build that they're playing here is playing as Zagara. To the right side of the map, Virtus.pro with a pretty innovative lineup once again, BKB on Diablo, Sefkaja on Vala, we have Unstable on Tyrande, Gela on Sonya, and Andy Lendi is playing Tassadar. And yeah, by the way, in case that you didn't know, Gela, by the way, female player, definitely the best female player that we have in Heroes of the Storm right now. So currently replacing Kuni-chan, who was let go after Prague. They played here, and I mean, I have to say it right now, that mount thing on Diablo is still the best in the game, hands down.
He like goes in and charges. He's already going in, but oh, stunned out just before the overpower. So the combo did not land, but good attempt there by BKB.
Yeah, so let's look a little bit at these builds. Of course, especially Diablo is going to occupy our thoughts a bit. The increase in your health regeneration already can get a pretty good sustain out there. We have also a bit of a slower attempt by Vala on level 1. Well, composite arrow doesn't really add a slow, but normally when you go for a composite arrow, you will see all of the Vala players that use that talent go into the slow on level 13 because you get the big range out of it, the most utility, so that's pretty cool. And the damage build that Virtus.pro is known for on Tyrande.
Yeah, starting off with that seasoned marksman. Sonya, taking a shot of Fury to begin with, just giving herself that ability to engage instantly no matter what and have the ability to do all her damage. And Tassadar taking the Psy infusion, just the fact that he's roaming between lanes and clearing these lanes a lot with the rest of his team.
Yeah, I still feel that this is one, for me, this is the globe map. So if you are roaming, then you still get the globes. I feel like this gives you a lot. But in this case, of course, since you had alts, the thing is what's really cool about the Psy infusion, I probably would still go for Conjurer's Pursuit. But one of the big benefits that you have on this map with Psy infusion is that you also have the additional spawns on the Webweavers that you can hit as well. So you always get like a massive amount of mana out of those. So it's actually pretty cool to have that here.
Yeah, I actually do think I prefer Psy infusion here due to the fact that you're spamming your storm more than you would be otherwise. You're spamming it on two lanes, meaning that you need that mana regen in order to help your team clear the lanes, whereas the Conjurers is very much a late game ability where you're actually going to be using your Storm less than you do in the early game with this.
That's definitely true, but on the other hand, as a counter-argument, you could say that through the fact that you are actually on two lanes active the entire time, you get a lot more stacks than you would go.
It's very much a choice between early game clearing the lanes and gaining map control, and late game having your mana to spam your shit.
And to be fair, I mean, like, this is one of the maps where a lot of teams right now try to get that early game momentum. So in this case, what you just said is absolutely true, and it would help you out with that early game presence there. Talking about the early game presence, by the way. There's a guy at the bot lane taking out. But talking about the early game presence here for a second, one of the main like thought process behind playing as Zagara and Sylvanas on this map is that you're trying to hit level 10 before your opponent does. You usually attempt to just like get a lead in experience by dropping structures, and then you get after your first web weaver wave that you try to turn in before your opponent, the second one, so to say, for free, because your opponent can't contest you since you have the earlier heroic ability. There's that sunlock that we start talking about! Exactly that combo, and Virtus.Pro with a great kill against Muradin.
Yeah, they've managed to hit this quite a few times now. That's how Zagara went down in the bot lane, and now with Muradin as well. The fact that you can kill a Muradin that quickly just shows the power of this. And Diablo, with his level 4, taking the Fire Devil, so he now has that surrounding flame doing damage over time, and the Searing Arrows on the side to Roger. And just in time with the overpower there, Zagara's gone again!
And it's that follow-up from Sonya that we've been talking about. That spear hitting hard, and then Gila just there and hits that. By the way, I really love like the pink skin and also like riding the picking style here. That's absolutely awesome. If you ride a money pick, then you have already won my heart. Like, that's definitely the best, for me personally, the best mod in the game.
Well, that was one of my favorite things. Like, back before this skin had a helmet, and it was just a blonde pink Sonya. It was also one of my favorite pictures ever, where it was just Sonya in that skin mid-leap.
That didn't work!
No!
That's poor Sylvanas!
I feel bad.
I feel really bad for her as well. Trying to escape with a haunting wave, and instead of crossing the wall, you actually get stuck in front of it.
It's and like Diablo bolting and falling just short.
Yeah, BKB was already turning around, and then he was just like, wait a second. Come back here, come back here.
The other one is like Falstad trying to barrel roll and just barrel roll. We saw that. I can't remember which game, but I think it was Blade. It just went straight into the wall.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I remember that. It happened like 3 or 4 times in the game as well. It was brutal. That poor Falstad player back then. There's nothing worse than the feeling when you actually miss one of these spells or like you hit the timing wrong and then you die because of it. Nothing worse. But well, in this case, it's also like a pretty bad scenario here for 2 out of 10 because like they are really paying the price right now. First of all, we have at level 4 the Leeching Plasma and the Carlos Embrace and Tacitus already called during the draft. It makes perfect sense to go for these talents if you're playing with a Sonya in your setup, and they are completely focusing on this. I love that we have not the focus attack but the Searing Arrows taken out, and since this talent was also buffed in the last patch, a lot of teams ignore it right now and go into focus attack instead if they're trying to play a seasoned Marksman Tauranda, which is actually a lot more common than you might think. But I love that Virtus.Pro is really staying true to their old-school style, even especially since this talent has been buffed. So that's pretty nice to see.
Yeah, they're just looking so solid at the moment. Like you said, the style is almost exactly the same, and they're still nailing it. And they're going on to Rhaegar. No, overpower. BKB just microing backwards a bit there, meaning he missed the overpower, unable to catch out that Rhaegar.
Yeah, well, at this point, I also want to give a big shout-out to two Diablo lovers that we have. First of all, to Shem2, who might or might not be watching and adores the hero, and also to Breeze, who at some point told me that he's going to be the hero to bring Diablo back. This is how it's done,
too
buddy.
Too late.
BKB got you beat to the punch, apparently. But, well, we have that turn in attempt now by the blue team, and they are already in that position. And keep in mind that this is really the moment where they can attempt to just get that experience with, well, and as I said, we have the 10 setting. It is Leap. It is indeed Leap with the Breath of Fire. Oh my god, value wall right there.
What's going on? Starfall as well. No heals. It's just the shield, the full damage to Ronda.
Wow.
Starfall, Force Wall, Leap. The Strafe and Lightning Breath.
Okay, like this was actually a moment where, that was perfect. First, Gila with the leap, and you hear that, whoa, and you're like, yes! So the first one coming in right away, then afterwards, this perfect force wall right here, Breath of Fire coming in. What a brutal play here. A 3-level lead, 7 kills against Zero, and Virtus.Pro rocking the style that we love. That's the aggression. That's exactly why we love this team, because they always make it fun.
This is actually the story I was going on about earlier before a fight happened, where basically it is a picture of a Sonya midway through Leap, and it just has the lyrics to Barbie Girl on it. And it's just like, come on, Barbie, let's go party. Oh!
Sometimes I hate you. Why did you have to put that picture in my head? Why? I mean, why? That was totally unnecessary and uncalled for. All right. We have level 11 versus 9. So the big problem here for the pushing team is, like, normally you want to be ahead at this point. You don't want to be the team that is behind. You're strong in the early game. You're strong when you can push in with Sylvanas, with Zagara. Like, the early game is yours, but this is the exact opposite. And this is now the big problem that they have. Leap is ready. There's the force wall. They're already zoning. And look at BKB. Balls to the wall straight behind it. He's just not even caring. He's walking into the range of the key base. He just, or the fort, saying, like, hey, whoever wants, I'm here.
If you step out of position, I'm going to get you. Yeah. Sylvanas getting dangerously close to BKB's range there.
Diablos is saying you want a piece? No problem.
Oh, he wants it so bad. But Surgeon just able to micro just on the
God,
lip.
Look at those web weavers now. They're timing the leap and the stun. Sylvanas dead. And they're going straight for Rhaegar. Breath of Fire. I mean, use the force wall of death. What
wow.
is this? The force wall of doom. You know, if BKB wouldn't have been that fast with the trigger on his lightning breath, lightning breath, he could have killed all three of them.
Maybe if he'd actually just got in there and done that if he'd left that a bit quicker later.
Yeah, he needed to move in just a bit further for that force wall, yeah.
Yeah, it's nothing worse than having someone just walk just out of the range of your lightning breath and you're just like, no, come back. There's the combo. Jade is gone. Muradin's surrounded. He is getting a burst down. Looks like he may escape, though.
Yeah, but look at that mini-map. Like, all of the forts are gone. The keep is going to be destroyed. 10 yeah, kills against zero. This is
work.
A slaughter. Just like, what? The more there. There's the tens. And
shield the lightning breath trying to take down Rhaegar. Rhaegar gets away.
Look at Tessitar. No hit points. Andy Lendy's just moving back. It's 11
and
kills
BKB
against zero.
As well. Like, both Andy Lendy and BKB getting out on almost zero hit points. BKB even cancelling his lightning breath, I'm pretty sure, just to get out of there.
Wow. Zero kills so far for 2 out of 10. And, like, they did not see that combo coming.
No.
And to be honest with you, neither did I. Like, that is pretty awesome. That's Virtus.Pro style right there.
I am also part of the not seeing this coming club, because that...
That Diablo last pick is like, what?
Yeah, that was... Then I was like, okay, so what could they combo with Apoc? I was with you on that one. Like, Lady Breath would be cool, but what could they combo with Apoc? And then, like you said, the fight was perfect. Like, leap. And then lightning breath, and then fourth one is just like, stop bombarding me with fun.
And they go for boss, like, they completely dictate this game right now. They do whatever they want. They want the boss, they get a boss. They want a keep, they get a keep. They're just, and now they want a dwarf. They want the dwarf, and they will get him.
Oh, this is amazing. Virtus.Pro, I do love you so.
I feel very sorry, though, for 2 out of 10.
I also feel sorry for them. They're moving in. The keep's already gone. Looks like they just want to end the game. Just going to push in here. 5 versus 4. Muradin's up in 10 seconds. Boss is slow.
Talking
about ballsy.
Wait
for that.
In
comes Diablo. There's the stun. And Sylvanas doesn't even get Ancestral. She goes down. There's the Lightning Breath onto the core.
The boss is on the core now as well. BKB might be the first one to die here for Virtus.Pro, but he still gets away.
Ooh.
The triple more is hitting hard.
No, the force wall to prevent the blizzard. They're able to just walk away.
BKB unstable. They're all so low, but look at that core. We are 11 minutes
Sonya
in.
Died.
Sonya is down.
Report
so is
feed.
Vala. But guess what? The core falls to. This is the 2-0 Virtus.Pro. They move on to the semi-final to face Gamers 2 tomorrow.
And those two together is a matchup we've seen a lot of times and seen a lot of fun stuff in. As I really doubt the Virtus.Pro will run that in that kind of copy that matchup, but I so hope they run it again.
How cool would it be?
It was so cool.
Dude, I hate that it was 11 minutes. I mean, it was.
I want more. Yeah, it was very quick game. Like, I wouldn't call it cheese, but the thing is, it was just all in. Like, look at the talents quickly. Not a single healing talent was taken except for Leeching Plasma. Leeching Plasma and Color's Embrace were the only defensive talents the entire game.
I still want to point
except
out
Scotia,
that
sorry.
Rhaegar had 14,000 heal at the end of the game. We had Tyrande on 14,000 healing as well without Shadowstock. And
yeah, to be
we
fair,
had
it's hard to heal when you're dead. And it's hard to heal your allies when they're dead.
Pointing. We had Tassadar at 25,000 here, like just saying. So, dude, like, I mean, this game was fun. This was really, really fun.
Yeah.
Okay. I enjoyed that Diablo a lot. That's actually like the perfect game to end of the day after.
Yeah,
like,
I agree. I literally, cool. just for a second, I tabbed into the stream and someone just put, what is health? Very appropriate for that last game.
Okay, guys, let's look at the bracket real quick because we, of course, have to check out what's going on tomorrow when we have the semifinals and everything starting. And brackets are right here, right now. So you can already tell that we are starting things off with Puit Crew versus Fnatic. Puit Crew actually showing us some really nice style with the Tyranda like solo several times now today already.
More of it running with a healing style as opposed to the style we just saw, and they nailed it. So it's very interesting to see the bans that Fnatic run with tomorrow.
Yeah, and at the single time, we also now have that setup where we are seeing, of course, the second semifinal, which we just like talked about, where we had the Gamers 2 boys from Poland going up against Virtus.Pro, so that's going to be pretty good as well. And that's going to be something that we are going to enjoy too tomorrow. That would be a pretty sick game, actually, I feel. Gamers 2 was playing a very, very solid match today, and yeah, that was actually really nice what we had there as well. So, that being said, here we go. Yeah. I'm getting that. You want to switch?
No. I just you have this thing with every single time when you start the stream or when you change something back. You're just like, button. Is it working? Yeah, it's good.
I tell you, the one time I'm not going to do that, it's just going to show my head throughout the entire game, like something like that, and everybody's like, what is this glare? What's going on here? Exactly. So guys, we're done for the day. I hope that you enjoyed the show. We're going to be back tomorrow. As we already said, 4 p.m. CET is going to be the time when we start streaming. We have four games tomorrow, four best of three series, so it's going to be pretty awesome. One team will go to China, only one of them, and we're going to find out tomorrow which team that is. So yep, thank you very much for tuning in today. That show was a pleasure.
It is always a pleasure.
And we're going to see you boys tomorrow. So have a good one, and bye-bye.